Recorded Books presents So Far and Good by John Straley. Narrated by David Chandler. In a trailer park or government housing somewhere in America, there is a woman who was born with the body of a man. When she gets in an argument with her neighbor, she rushes outside in her robe with her makeup badly applied. The other neighbors call her a freak, or worse, an animal, and they film her. She carries a pistol in her underwear because she feels forsaken. She carries a razor in the pages of her Bible because she is hungry for salvation. This book is dedicated to her, because I am her brother. We live in an occupied country misunderstood. Justice will take us millions of intricate moves. Sirens will hunt down Berkey, you survivors in your beds listening through the night, so far and good. William Stafford, Thinking for Berkey. Chapter 1. The Test. It's not hard remembering how long you have been in prison. Days pass and your daughter's birthdays, holidays without the usual food, then seasons go by, a fall where you need a wool cap but don't have one, a winter where slush wets your socks in the exercise yard, and your feet may stay wet all day depending how many pairs of socks you have, and a spring where unseen songbirds titter from the rocky field beyond the coils of razor wire. I can remember how long I have been in. What bothers me is that as time goes on, I begin to forget when, if ever, I will be getting out. There is a single time-accounting sergeant who is in charge of keeping the book on time. He or she keeps track of your time, down to the minute you were logged into jail when you were first booked in on your charges. The TA sergeant also calculates your good time. In Alaska, for every 3 days of time in prison that you don't cause any trouble, you earn 1 day off your sentence. But not always. If you participate in certain rehabilitative services, that time within the program does not earn good time. It can be tricky to know how much time you have officially lost for certain infractions. Inmates are supposed to be informed of loss of good time, but often that information slips through the cracks. Infractions can be written up or not, and inmates are never sure if the report makes it into the hands of the probation officer and then to the TA sergeant. An inmate can ask for a TAA, or a time accounting audit, but it's a pretty big deal. And it's generally believed that unless your attorney requests the audit with some justification by the court, the TA sergeant will simply add days or weeks just for making them go through the extra work. The truth of it is, no one ever likes the answer the TA sergeant gives, so most of us don't ask. We wait. I was originally sentenced to 25 years. But my lawyers and I went before the three-judge panel, and I gave the longest allocution in the history of Alaska, and they lowered my sentence to 7 years. On the day I'm writing this, I have served 4 years. I'm close to what should have been my release date, but the events I am writing about occurred 6 months ago. It wasn't too long after the decision of the three-judge panel, and I was still feeling the weight of the 25 lift off my back. I was floating, sad still and sick of being inside, but floating. Perhaps it was the floating that made me do some of the stupid things that resulted in my losing a chunk of good time and set this whole horrific shitstorm roaring through every part of my life, my caged life, and my free life, too. So I wait, and I spend the time writing. I know I lost some good time, but I'm not sure how much and what for. It could be months or a year. My lawyer doesn't want me writing anything down, of course, but I have to. I want to write it all down, not because I'm trapped inside prison, but because I'm frightened of prison being trapped inside of me. During the years I have spent here, I have seen human beings so overwhelmed by rules, walls, and changing protocols that they become pale with something I once thought was the result of insanity or inconsolable grief. They take in everything they ever used to enjoy as if it were now an insult to the very idea of pleasure. The food, the sex, the work, the books they read, the art they make, it is all meaningless without the freedom to enjoy it. Just 2 weeks ago, a story made the rounds about a guy who made it out after being in prison for 12 and a half years. He had dreamed of rebuilding his motorcycle and riding it to the Arctic Circle with a big-breasted girl riding bitch on the back. Well, the girl, who was almost 40 years old, bailed somewhere outside of Toke Junction, not far up the highway. Because the bike's hard suspension hurt her back so much, she decided she would rather work in a roadhouse serving wildland firefighters than rattle her way up that bumpy road. Once alone, our man became more and more obsessed with limitations, speed limits, and traffic signs. He was in violation of his parole and screaming across the northern tundra, trying to eat up the horizon before his arms turned numb or the bugs and road dust sealed his eyes shut. But eventually, even a straight road to the horizon seemed too limiting, too narrow. Word came back to us that the RCMP found him wrapped around a bridge abutment somewhere in the Northwest Territories, his bike in pieces, and his body having been consumed by scavengers. A majority of the inmates, even the short-timers, envied him. This is all a long way of saying that I am writing this story about my daughter to remind myself of a certain kind of freedom that I want to carry in my mind throughout this entire experience inside. It's a freedom that I associate with my daughter's goodness, and maybe, more broadly, with just the possibility of human goodness. There were several investigations concerning the events that caused me to lose good time and will keep me in here until I don't know when. One was conducted by the Alaska State Troopers and the Department of Corrections. Another by the Office of Child Protective Services, which got involved, as you will soon learn. Obviously, I wasn't present to see anything that happened outside Lemon Creek Correctional Center, so in writing this, I wanted to double-check the facts from those investigations. My attorney was given those reports. I've also had the advantage of being able to talk with my daughter, Blossom Younger. She gave me her written reports, letters, and diary, which you might think is a rare display of openness between a teenage girl and her incarcerated father. In truth, she gave me all her written materials in order to hide them from the other investigations, which turned out to be a well-reasoned ploy because my lawyer and the Department of Corrections threw up quite a few walls against the discovery of my personal possessions. No adult investigator thought there would be much of Blossom's stuff in my possession. Blossom spoke with me during her visits about what happened in the basement, and she cried like a baby, long after her bruises had healed and the cuts had sealed together and the stitches had come out. She wept without control. But she hadn't cried when it first happened. Then she was a tough and smart-mouthed teenager who could handle all the troubles of the adult world, thank you very much. She thought she was a freedom fighter, and she thought she was fighting for my freedom, bless her soul. But once she learned I had that more or less covered, she started opening up to me and her mother, and her rage all spilled out like the insides of a gutted fish. Those were her words. She made me promise not to paint her as a wimp in this account, and as you will see, there is nothing wimpy about our daughter. But you might judge me harshly and miss my love for her if I didn't clue you in to her tender nature. I write now in pencil on a yellow pad. Several yellow pads, actually. I usually work while I'm at my job in the library or when I'm alone in my bunk. I make two copies of everything I write, and I hide both copies, one in a safe place and the other with a person I trust. I write to keep from beating my head against the wall for whatever time I have left in here, and I write to remember how much I love my daughter. That love is the most civilizing force that remains in my life. Loving her and respecting her, eventually learning to let her go, will make me a valuable human being. At least that is the belief I cling to. I'll tell this story as if I were on the outside with Blossom. She is only 17, but she thinks of herself as my partner in our investigative business, which isn't true, but there is nothing much I can do about that now. I enjoy writing as if I know what she is thinking and what happened to her. I also believe this account is accurate. For all the harm and what ultimately happened to her, I am deeply sorry, but again, there is nothing to be done about it now. Blossom's mother is Jane Marie D'Angelo. We were married in a small ceremony in Sitka on the beach out near the ferry dock. Blossom is our only child. Jane Marie was born and raised in Juneau. Her sister and her family still live in the family home there. Jane Marie lives on her boat, the Winning Hand. Our friend and the man I'm supposed to take care of, Todd, now lives in Jane Marie's sister's house. Todd didn't like living on the boat. Jane Marie takes it out at unexpected times. And he is now working at a nursing home downtown and takes his schedule very seriously. Even though there is a lot of noise in the house with people coming and going, it is near the nursing home, close to the Capitol building, and Todd has a tiny room where he is comfortable. Blossom sees him every day, and she takes him shopping whenever he needs anything. They also enjoy going to the movies in Juneau, where there are more choices than in Sitka, where we used to live. Jane Marie is a research scientist and professor at the University of Alaska. She moors her boat, which doubles as a research vessel, in Aurora Harbor, which is close to Juneau Douglas High School, where Blossom goes to school. I'm incarcerated at Lemon Creek Correctional Center, some 8 miles down the road from the high school. Jane Marie also works out of a small office near St. Anne's Rest Home downtown, where Todd is a custodian, and from there she can see the tourists walking up the hill from the cruise ships on summer days, and the legislators trudging back toward the Capitol in the rain during winter. I think of her stooped over her computer there, with her old-fashioned milk crates filled with notebooks and reports. I imagine framed pictures of Blossom as a child hanging on the white wall, smiling on the deck of a boat, her life jacket on and sun filling her eyes and dazzling her hair. Blossom got her driver's license in Juneau the day after her 16th birthday. Her uncle had a 1993 Renault LeCar that he dearly loved and preserved. It had only a few hundred miles on it, and it was kept dry and salt-free in his garage. He allowed Blossom free use of it under two strict conditions. One, she had to park it in the garage every night and lock the door. And two, she had to pressure wash every inch of the car top to bottom at a setting selected by Uncle Pete, and then she had to adequately dry it before putting it away. While most teenage girls would consider these rules draconian, Blossom was eager to follow them because she loved the car with a kind of devotion usually reserved for religious artifacts. The car was blue and had a nearly full-length sunroof. It was French, zippy, unique, and yet somehow uncool among people who knew cars. It had a unibody construction, which meant that it would probably have the lifespan of James Dean out on the highway in the rainy climate of Juneau, Alaska, and was more than likely to crack in half on the few miles of freeway than it was to get into an accident. It had two small seats in front and two in the back. With the roof open, it felt like a convertible on a sunny day. It had a stick shift, and learning to operate it made Blossom feel like a race car driver. She doted on this car and would fight almost anyone who didn't wholeheartedly admire it in a parking lot. On the day that her adventure started, she drove to Lemon Creek at visiting hours, and the guard who checked her in kept making offers on the car. "I'm telling you, Stanley, it's my uncle's car, and besides, I would never, ever in this world let him sell it. That car is my baby. I'm telling you, man."
"Girl, you need yourself something bigger for all your boyfriends," Stanley said, "and something safer. That little tin can is going to crush up on you. You just better give that little go-kart to old Stanley to take care of."
"Nice try. No way." She smiled at him as the thick door buzzed and he showed her through. After months of trips and paperwork, we had been allowed contact visits in which we could sit in the same room. Despite this designation, though, we were careful not to touch each other because if we were seen touching, Blossom could be subject to a body search on the way out, everything from a light pat-down to a complete cavity search. Though the search would be conducted by a female officer, it could be traumatizing and sometimes punitive. That is, done in a way to discourage a visitor from ever coming back. Visitors had been known to be stripped and kept waiting in a cold holding room for hours while appropriate personnel was found to perform the search. There was no indication that the prison staff had anything against Blossom or me, but it was difficult to know what was going on in my jacket or file or in hers, so it was best to be careful. There were several cheap sofas, three vending machines for sodas and snacks, and three tables with chairs. I sat at the table farthest from the door. A black inmate and his wife and baby girl sat on the couch by the oldest candy machine. The baby girl sat on her daddy's lap. She had a red bow in her hair and smiled like a crescent moon. The mom had tears in her eyes. As Blossom passed the small family, she cupped the baby's head in her hand and stopped a moment to kiss her. "Hey, Akaya, baby. You look so sweet today."
"How you, darling?" the woman asked.
"You know. How about you, Alicia?"
"Same. Thanks for asking, girl."
"You take care. Promise to call me for babysitting?"
"Hell yes."
"Good."
Then my daughter walked to our table and sat across from me. Blossom was well into her junior year. She had missed more than a whole school year after the mess with her being kidnapped, and then me and my friends kind of blowing up the hotel where she was being held. Blossom needed a break after that. Her mother was great about it and didn't push her. Blossom spent a lot of time rowing a dory around the sound and hiking the mountains with some friends and sometimes with her mom. Blossom worked in her mom's lab and eventually got all of her science and English credits from the college. She became an expert shot with a pneumatic rifle and a crossbow and took DNA samples from orca, sperm, and humpback whales for her mom's lab. The sperm whales were offshore when the black cod season opened. Blossom often got rides on fishing boats out near the shelf edge, and when the fishermen pulled in their gear, sperm whales would pick the oily codfish off their lines. And Blossom would put her dory in the ocean from the fishing boat, then row up next to the large males to shoot a small dart into their back, which would bounce out with a plug of skin and blubber the size of a pencil eraser. She would preserve and mark the sample, which would be used to identify the animal and could also be tested for diet, contamination, and biological health. Perhaps this is just a freedom fantasy of mine, but I have spent a lot of time in my iron bunk on the thin mattress, imagining her in her wooden dory beyond the sight of land, riding the swells with nothing but the albatross squawking around her as the oars rattle in their locks. Out where there are no highway lines, but a few friendly faces keeping a hopeful eye out, as they ride the swells that hug the curve of the earth. Blossom's face is more relaxed and mature than it was a few years ago. She is smarter and maybe wiser, but she is still impulsive, and I worry about her. Anger comes quick, and this hunger to set the world right, while I understand it and am in no position to offer counsel, runs hot. Soon she will have a lot of important decisions to make, and I grieve every day that I'm in here and that the fucker who hurt her so badly will always play some role in all those decisions. So, Blossom said, how's the convict?
I'm good.
Shank anybody lately?
Not lately. How's school?
School is good. You will be happy to know that I, too, have not killed anyone lately.
This is progress. How are your friends? Your car?
The Le Car is fantastic. Dad, I can't wait to drive you around in it.
You following your uncle's rules?
Rust is my mortal enemy.
How is your boyfriend?
Ned is not my boyfriend. He just likes me. We're friends. He has a cool motorcycle.
You know you're not allowed on the back of that thing if any, and I mean any, alcohol has been consumed. Have I mentioned that?
1 million times?
Any alcohol. That means one drop of beer. Don't talk to me about blood alcohol levels or legal limits. The limit is zero.
Says the convict, in prison.
She looked at me and smiled, and I knew she understood me. I wouldn't have known a few years ago. Now I do. She's tall now. Her hair has grown out, and the clothes she wears don't take on the aspect of a costume as much as they used to. Where she once dressed like a girl from a horror movie, she now seems to make an effort to complement her features and coloring, and she has incorporated some sense of practicality and takes the weather into account. But again, she might be doing all of this for my benefit in the visiting room, so that I take the least amount of anxiety back inside as possible. I don't really know why, but it makes me cry sometimes back in my cell when I consider how much she has grown and how sweet she has become. How's Todd, B?
He doesn't like living in Juneau.
She made a sour face, like she didn't really want to talk about it.
What, he doesn't like staying at Priscilla's house? He's okay with, well, you know Aunt P, she yells a lot, and Todd doesn't like that. He pretty much hides in his room most of the time. He listens to his podcasts about the law and about church stuff.
Is he becoming a Christian?
No, he just likes to pray a lot.
Somebody at the place he works got a hold of him and got him into praying. It's not bad, don't worry. I keep talking to him. It's good.
Well, honey, what does he pray for?
Dad, let's talk about something else.
Blossom, now you've got me worried. What does Todd pray for?
He prays for you to get out of jail and for us to go home to Sitka.
I sat there, not speaking. Of course he would, I thought. Todd is my age and is a functioning adult man with autism who was screwed up by trauma and a kind of indifferent abuse when he was a kid. Tweezing all his issues apart would be impossible now. What really helps him is unchanging routine and pretty constant reassurance that he's doing the right thing to keep the chaos of his childhood at bay. The fists and the belts, the tears and the wild, frightening death of his parents. Todd isn't sure how it works, but it seems as if the chaos stays away if he acts in a certain way, in a way that he can only guess at every day. Todd is a fine and gentle man, and most of my life I have tried to provide him with nothing but unconditional love. Of course, when I swerved off course and landed in jail to save my daughter, I abandoned him. Blossom knows this, and she tries to protect me from it.
Just try to help him, Blossom. I will, Pop. It would be better if I could give him a date to look forward to. You know him. He can almost hold his breath waiting for any date. He is amazing.
I know, sweetie, but first, I don't know a date, and second, I would hate to give him a date and not be able to keep the promise. I might lose some time or something might happen.
Nothing bad will happen, Pop. We will keep it together. You will get out pretty soon.
Okay. What else is going on? I asked. She bit her lip.
George is planning a surprise for her mom.
George is a girl at Blossom's new school, and Blossom adores her. They drive around and have their own little study group. George's mom is a Democratic legislator in the Alaska House of Representatives, and they live out in the Mendenhall Valley in a classic suburban house with a tire swing in the yard and a view of a glacier.
Can you tell me about the surprise? Well, George is getting her DNA tested from one of those places, and she snuck a sample from her mom.
What do you mean, snuck?
I don't know. I guess while her mom was sleeping, she swabbed her mouth.
Why in God's name would she do that?
George loves her mom so much, Pop. It's crazy. She has this plan to figure out their ancestry, and George is going to plan trips to all the countries they're from. George has saved up all of her summer job money since, like, forever, and she got people to donate airline miles into her account. She doesn't even know where they're going because she hasn't gotten the test back yet.
She should have asked her mom before she took her swab, don't you think?
It's a birthday surprise, Pop.
Yeah, I suppose, was all I said at the time. There were no real alarm bells going off other than I just don't like secrets, and this had the feel of something that could backfire. Ida Paul was married to Richard Paul. It turned out that Ida was of Irish, Welsh, German heritage, but her family and neighbors thought of her as white. Richard was Clinkett. George, their only daughter, had black hair, but other than that, everyone joked that she didn't appear to have picked up any of her dad's heritage. But he took it in stride, joking that Clinkett was a matrilineal society and that everything always came from the mother's side anyway, so it didn't surprise him in the least. George's real name was Georgiana, but she loved calling herself George Paul and had done so since junior high school. She liked to joke that she was half of the greatest band in the world and swore that if she ever married, it would be to someone named John and their child would have to be named Ringo.
After Blossom left that afternoon, I had other things on my mind than George's DNA test or the fact that she may have breached Ida Paul's trust by sneaking a swab into her cheek. I was going to have to go to my unofficial tutoring job in the prison, and I was starting a new section on poetry, which I was worried about and which, in fact, could get me killed if things went badly. That the two subjects, the DNA and my particular teaching curriculum, would eventually become inextricably related wouldn't become clear to me until much later, when everything had blown up like half a stick of dynamite in a prison toilet that no one stops using, no matter how plugged it gets. Chapter 2. Fourth Street, Aunt Jennifer and her Tigers. Friends write me letters wanting to know how I survive in jail. I don't know why they don't come right out and ask if I have become someone's bitch, which is what they both do and don't want to know. The fact is, I have become someone's bitch in a strange sort of way. And it is for this reason that on the day Blossom first told me about George and the DNA test, I was sweating bullets over how I was going to talk to my man, Albert Monroe, otherwise known as Fourth Street, about the poetry of Adrian Rich. Among people who have served hard time in other states, Alaska prisons, particularly Lemon Creek, are considered easy places to do time. This is partly because Alaska has few really hardened criminals. Alaska ranks very high in domestic violence, and while painkillers and heroin abuse are on the rise, alcohol abuse is by far the most prevalent. Sex abuse draws long sentences, and most sex abuse cases are cross-related with alcohol. Alaska also has a disproportionate number of Alaska natives behind bars and under the supervision of the DOC. Not because they are any more prone to criminality, but because they often suffer from a type of cultural dislocation, a failing economy and crowded housing problems, which leads to rapid reporting of all disputes. According to the Department of Corrections, Alaska Native men are not prone to violence and are very mellow in jail. They find safety in numbers and serve time quietly. Pacific Islanders and African Americans are overrepresented compared to their percentage of the population in Alaska, but here too, few of them are actual gangbangers. The most dangerous men in Alaska were the early pioneers of the drug trade in the 80s and 90s. They came from New York City when Rudy Giuliani lowered the murder rate by driving out the black crack dealers and allowing the Dominicans to take over the heroin business. For a time, the Dominicans came to Alaska to expand their drug trade and buy their guns because it was so damn cheap and easy. The Lamplighter Hotel shootings happened more than 30 years ago, but had quite an effect on the culture. A set of Dominican drug dealers came in and shot another gang and left them all for dead. But one guy got up, flushed the drugs, and even though he was shot through the jaw, called the cops on the rival gang. He became a street legend, and all the youngsters bought big, whopping handguns of their own and started shooting each other for stupid, drunk reasons since they didn't have business reasons to act on. These became the most dangerous men in Alaska, the wannabes. Real money-making gangsters of that era were swept up pretty quickly by state and federal law enforcement. State prisons had some stupid kids. But in each lockup in Alaska, there was at least one genuine hard-ass, a real gangbanger from California or Nevada, who did a nice, quiet, and violent business in Anchorage or Fairbanks, and who, while in state custody, would enlist genuine, dead-eyed killers to enforce order among the children to teach them manners. There were very few dead-eyed killers, but there were those who were vacant enough that a good leader could train them to become a decent prison protection outfit. Our boy from Sitka, who murdered his family, was psychotic but was not dangerous as long as he took his medication. But the old man from Anchorage, who had hunted prostitutes with a bow, was a celebrity and was eager to maintain his status. He knew he was never going to get out. He was a different story. The native hunter, who had done unspeakable things to several corpses in his hunting camp when he was blackout drunk, was a sweet and wise elder when sober and a peacemaker in jail. But the white sexual assault perp from the suburbs wanted nothing more than to earn his stripes as a genuine American badass by killing a black man in jail. When I first came to Lemon Creek, I had some friends and former clients who helped me, but they had short sentences, and they also got caught up in the circumstances of my case, so the prison officials tried their best to keep us separated. Plus, it was written into the terms of our probation that we were not to have contact with one another in any material way, written or telephonic, a wording that would let the Department of Corrections off the hook in the event that they had to house us together due to overcrowding. Until I came to prison, I enjoyed the privilege of being white and old. I'm almost 60 now, and I've been told by more experienced convicts that I have worried eyes that make me an easy mark. I had been an investigator for the Public Defender Agency, which made me unpopular to a large portion of the population and a popular object of ridicule for some of the weakest minds inside the walls. Within Lemon Creek, there are activity centers, classrooms, admin offices, and visiting areas, as well as kitchen, laundry, library, and sick bay facilities. All areas are joined by gated hallways and stairwells that allow for travel from the tiers or dorms for different inmates with different clearances at different times. When the facility is locked down, nothing can move at all. Doors are locked, and there is a hard body count, done by personnel, not by camera, because there are still a few blind spots for cameras. These lockdowns happen almost 5 times a day, but again, protocol changes. Early on, if I got trapped in a blind spot with the wrong person during lockdown, I could expect a beating. The first day I got caught out, I took a beating from a former client with a grudge. He broke my nose and opened up an old cut in my right eyebrow. The kid cut his knuckles on my teeth, so I'm tempted to say that I gave as good as I got, but not really. I got a lot worse. I made it to a bathroom I had never been in before. I didn't know that it was off limits to anyone who didn't have business with Mr. Monroe. I walked in and grabbed towels from the dispenser, and a very large and very feminine African-American man who was well-muscled and well over 6 feet tall looked at me and said, "Sweetheart, you very lost. You can't come in here to fix your boo-boo and get that juice all over Street's office. I just spent the morning scrubbing it. Shoo now, go on, girl, shoo." Later, I would find out that this person preferred the pronouns she, her. Her dead name was Sean Knight, and she had been an all-state N for a large Gary, Indiana military academy. She then went to 2 years of college on a football scholarship at Grinnell, where she found the black football players not as friendly as the members of the LGBTQ student union. So she left Iowa, became her true self, and began using the name Sean Day. She had stepped into the light. But all that information didn't come until much later. That first day, a very commanding voice said, "Sean Day, please give us the room." And that was the day I became one of the street's bitches. Albert Monroe had come from Hayward, California to Fairbanks in 1971. He had learned welding and had worked for a time on the pipeline, then saw there was an opportunity to make much more money selling cocaine and being a pimp. After the pipeline was built, Fairbanks longed for some more civilization, so Mr. Monroe moved to Anchorage, the main oil town in the state, where there had always been an appetite for cocaine and pussy. Mr. Monroe began with strip clubs and prostitution, card games and drugs along Fourth Avenue, hence his nickname. Eventually, his clubs moved out toward the smaller suburb of Spinard. Fourth Street was an old-school post-pipeline gangster. He was of mixed race, African, Hispanic, and Irish, and there was no one he couldn't charm. He was charged with murdering a man from Las Vegas who was said to be trying to move in on his business in Anchorage. The evidence against him was weak, and several snitches were used by the FBI. The snitches never served time in Alaska. One of the snitches was a man named Johnny Clark, who ran a card room in Spinard at his own house. Johnny Clark died of an apparent suicide in a transport cell in Seattle before the jury came in. The other snitch was unavailable to testify at trial, but the prosecutor was allowed to read the snitch's grand jury testimony to the jury as well as tell the jury about Clark's death, which was the subject of several appeals. The crazy boys who came into jail may not have known Street's reputation in the real world, but they were made aware of it as soon as they cleared the observation tank when they first booked in. Someone from Street's set would give them an orientation to Lemon Creek. Mine was gentle and much like a welcome wagon visit. I was old and educated. I wasn't violent, and Street seemed to like people with genuine legal knowledge. I had, in fact, been invited to have a sit-down with the man, an invitation I had declined, because it had been my plan to do my time unaffiliated with any criminal organization and as easily as possible, which was harder than you might think. I had already been stabbed once, but the homicide I was convicted for was the killing of a man who had trifled with my daughter. Even the hard guys in prison had some respect for that. But because I was charged for the killing, and because it was quite graphic with a lot of blood, and because it happened right in the shower room of my own dorm, and it appeared that I had some protection from a high-ranking police detective, inmates in this relatively mellow correctional institution gave me a grace period for a few weeks, until my former client cornered me in the hall and broke my nose.
"You are the famous Mr. Younger," Street said as he cradled my head in his large hands before the mirrors. Then he snapped the cartilage in my nose back in place. He reached under the sink and pulled out two small vials and uncorked them. Tilting my torso back as if we were dipping in a tango, he supported the small of my back with one hand while he packed one nostril at a time, pouring the powder and then using the blunt end of the vial to compress it.
"Don't sniff," he said. "Just let it absorb."
At first it hurt. But after he stood me up, my face began to numb, and I understood what was happening.
"You should have come see me sooner, Cecil."
"I like just doing my time."
"How's that working out for you?"
I didn't answer him, but looked at my face where the shadows under my eyes were starting to darken.
"What do I say when I start looking like a raccoon?" I asked him.
"Tell the officers you didn't see who hit you. They will believe that. You are a grandpa and not particularly popular. These boys would all love to break your nose just to tell their punk friends they hit their fucking lawyer."
"I'm not a lawyer."
"I know that, but they don't. I was friends with a few of your colleagues in Anchorage."
He mentioned a few names. Two men I knew well, big names in the field, respected names. and one woman who had been highly regarded until she got too involved with the cocaine industry. We didn't discuss details.
I want you to work for me, Mr. Younger.
As I said, Street, I simply want to do my time.
Don't call me Street. Let's be professional. You can call me Mr. Monroe.
I'm sorry. I meant no disrespect.
I'm certain of that.
I am willing to listen respectfully to your proposal, Mr. Monroe, I said, realizing as I spoke that my diction was becoming somewhat stilted. If you will respect my ability to make my own decision about whether or not to accept.
Huh? He looked at me and smiled. You know, I could just break all your teeth and fuck your mouth until you walk out of here and...
And then he listed a very specific number of months, weeks, and days, which made me wonder if he had seen my official time accounting.
It worried me so much I didn't even remember the amount of time I had left to serve.
Yes, I said. I know you could do that, but I have a feeling you would have done that already if that was all you wanted from me. And I'm betting what you actually want would be better done if I were more willing and if I had teeth.
I suppose that is true.
So, what do you really want from me?
I have a parole hearing coming up in 24 months. There are four white women sitting on the parole board. I want you to teach me how to speak respectfully to these bitches.
To the white women on the board?
To all of them. My lawyer's a woman. It didn't used to be this way, but everywhere I go now, there are white bitches as lawyers. I don't want them fucking up my chances in 24 months. I got some things cooking so that I may have a shot. But I'm old like you now, and I don't want to come back inside. I don't understand shit on the outside anymore. Money doesn't take care of everything for a black man. You gotta understand white women now. You have to be correct, you know what I'm saying? I've got to know how to talk to them. The world is different from when I came in here. Plenty of them are judges. They're the ones writing the laws, and even if they aren't the judges, they are the clerks. I feel like even if they aren't running things directly, the white men like you are so fucking afraid of the bitches they are in effect running everything. I got to know how to talk to these bitches. I know you do. You fucking slit a man's throat and your white woman lawyer got your full bid down to 7 years. And you the most fucking hated white man I know. That's some deep skill. You talked for hours to those judges. Two of them on the three-judge panel were white bitches.
My allocution to the judges had become legendary in the prison system, since I had spoken to them for the longest time on record, almost 8 hours, and had walked away with a greatly reduced sentence. Well, not referring to them as bitches would be a place to start, I muttered.
I don't need you to tell me what to say to you,
he said.
I need you to tell me how to talk to the white women on the fucking parole board, you understand that?
I stared at him for a moment. You know it's not that easy, right? I mean, I don't know any magic words to get along with women. You are the greatest pimp of all time. You are the man who can talk with women.
Those were my bitches. I'm talking lawyers and shit. I want to talk all that smart stuff so that they will want to respect me, want to see me as a real person and worth keeping out of jail. They did that for you.
For me? Really?
Fuck yes. They did amazing shit for you. That was skill. The motherfucking judges hated you. They wanted to make an example of your ass to show the press how we don't just throw brown people in jail. I could not believe the sentence you got.
There are women teachers who visit the prison who could help you, aren't there?
Fuck that. I don't want to sit and listen to a bunch of lectures about Plessy versus Ferguson and shit. I don't want to hear about how Reconstruction was the most pivotal time in our country's history for race relations. I want to know the current language of fucking power, goddammit.
Why don't you study finance?
Shit, I know finance. Buy low, sell high. Give people what they want. Lower wages as much as you can. Dilute the product as much as the customer can stand. Crush your competition until the cops come after you. Buy off the regulators. Avoid all the taxes you can, but don't draw attention to yourself. Bury the bodies deep. That stuff is easy. What I want is to be accepted as a human being and not to be put in a cage by language again. You know these things. I want to talk with you. I want you to teach me new words, new ideas, ideas the white people respect and that will help an old black man make money and stay out of jail.
Are you going to break my teeth?
I have to let people think that I'm doing that because that is the only way things get done in this place. Fear, sex, and broken bones. I will give you a pass. It's bad for me, you know, so you don't get a free pass. But because of your special gift, I will give you a choice. You understand that if I don't break your teeth, every con out there will think that I am doing you and you like it.
I will take that risk, but I have to tell you, I'm not into smoking your pole.
Don't dismiss it out of hand, Professor. I might grow on you.
The other large person in the room shook her shoulders suddenly as if she had been stung by a bee and turned her back to us. Listen, I said, drawing the word out, trying to think of the next thing to say, wondering if it was going to catch me another broken bone. How about we study this problem together? The best we can. I'll get some books. You choose some books. We'll talk about them. We'll talk about our own experience. We will have to practice which words to use when you go before the parole board, and we'll work on getting your mind right before you talk to these women. Women, okay? Who have so much power over your future. That's what I can do, but I can't guarantee anything, Mr. Monroe. I can't promise a result, you understand?
You already talking like a fucking bitch.
Then he smiled and held his hand out to me.
Okay, then. It's a deal. Now take those pants off.
Wait, that's not...
I'm fucking with you.
Okay.
I looked at him skeptically.
Deal, then, I said. And that's how I became Mr. Albert Monroe's private tutor and bitch.
That was months ago.
It had been a struggle. We started with a book called You Just Don't Understand by Deborah Tannen, which provoked a lot of vigorous debate in our entire section of the prison. The concept Dr. Tannen tries to make clear is that the conversational style of men is shaped by the desire to gain status or power, while women focus more on intimacy or finding consensus. This prompted a lot of arguments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.